The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope secures. He will my share and portion me as long as life.
Let's say it's good to be coming your way. We appreciate you watching. We always enjoy every week that we come and get to do this program with you. We enjoy it. And give you an invitation real quickly. Come be with us at Lacy's Chapel, Henniger. Go to Henniger Crossing. Take 40 West like you're going to Scottsboro. Church is 3 miles on your left. We'd love to have you. It's a great church. Got some wonderful people in it. Some really, really good people in it. And God's blessed your church. Give you an invitation to come be with us. If you got your Bible today, we're going to look at a verse, then we're going to turn. We're going to look at one verse, and it's in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. It's what Paul said. And he said, "For we walk by faith," it's 2 Corinthians 5, 7, "and not by sight." He says, "For we walk by faith and not by sight." And if God allows next 2 or 3 or 4 weeks, I'd like to look at this verse with different people. But God says, "We walk by faith and not by sight." So God is teaching us to walk by faith, faith in His word, not by sight. And if you got your Bibles in Deuteronomy, we're going to look at Deuteronomy. Chapter 8 of Deuteronomy, we're going to look at this verse real quick. Deuteronomy chapter 8, we're talking about walking by faith. We walk by faith and not by sight. Deuteronomy chapter 8, we're going to look at it real quickly and see how that what God told Moses. Paul said, "We walk by faith," faith in God's word. Faith in what God has said, faith in God's promises, and not what we see. Not what we see. So we're going to look at this real quick. Here's what God told Moses. He said, "All the commandments," Deuteronomy 8 and 1, "all the commandments which I command thee this day shall you observe to do, that you may live and multiply and go in and possess the land which the Lord sware unto your fathers." So this is what God tells Moses. "All the commandments which I command thee this day shall you observe to do." In other words, God told Moses, "The commandments that I have give you, the commandments that I have give you, observe to do that you may live." And you know, everybody knows the verse, John 10 and 10. Jesus said, "I come that you may have life and have it more abundantly." He said, "Observe to do these commandments." In other words, what I've commanded you, do. "That you may live and multiply." In other words, God told Moses, "I'm wanting to bless you. I'm wanting to bless your nation. I'm wanting to bless you. I'm wanting to bless these people. I'm wanting to bless your nation." He says, "What I command you is, observe to do what I've told you to do." In other words, God is simply saying, do what I've commanded you. If you want to be blessed and you want to be multiplied and you want to have the abundant life, He said, observe to do what I've commanded you. In other words, do what I've commanded you. So, He said, "That you may live, multiply, and go and possess the land which the Lord sware unto your fathers." So God had promised them the land. God had promised them the land, but He said, if you're going to go in it and possess it and live in it and be multiplied, in other words, if you want to receive God's blessings, He says, observe to do what I've commanded you. In other words, God told them to be obedient to what He had told them. He said in verse 2, "Thou shalt remember all the way which the Lord thy God led thee these 40 years in the wilderness to humble thee." And you know, God told, this is amazing. We you know, you can read about the 40 years the children of Israel were in the wilderness that Moses led them. And you can read about they complained about no water, and they complained about no food, and they complained about they wanted meat to eat. But God tells them in this verse, he said, "Thou shalt remember all the way which the Lord thy God led these 40 years in the wilderness to humble thee." So God told them, said, I was humbling you. In other words, God didn't want them prideful. He didn't want them doing their own thing. He wanted them to be obedient, not proud, but to be humble and to be obedient so that he could bless them. I mean, this is, if you really read the Word of God and you say the Word of God, you can look at all the things they went through, and God said, "I was humbling you. I was making you humble." And he's going to tell them in a minute, "I was making you humble so I could bless you." Well, the Bible said pride goes before destruction and a haughty spirit before a fall. Pride goes before destruction. And the sin that got Satan kicked out of heaven, Isaiah 14, Satan was an angel. But, he said in his heart, I will exalt my throne above the throne of God. Before the fall, his name was Lucifer. He was an angel. He led in worship. But he fell, and a third of the angels were cast out of heaven because of pride. He said, "I will exalt my throne above the throne of God. I will, I will, I will." He said it seven times. "I will be like the Most High God. I will exalt my throne above the throne of God." He said, "I will," seven times. So Satan, why he got cast out, the original sin was pride. The original sin, the first sin, was pride. Satan got kicked out of heaven because of pride. "I will, I will, I will." Well, pride is about the building up of yourself. It's what pride is. Well, God's telling the nation of Israel, and he's talking to Moses. He said, "I want to bless you. But the first thing you got to do is humble you." The Bible said pride goes before destruction and a haughty spirit before a fall. Pride goes before destruction and a haughty spirit before a fall. One of the worst enemies that we have is pride. And it simply means that, the building up of yourself. A prideful person is going to do their own thing. They don't receive correction. They don't want instruction. They have the answers. And it's amazing. God told the nation of Israel, "My plan is for you to live and multiply. I want to bless you, but I had to humble you." One of the greatest benefits in life, is to be able to listen, to be able for a person to talk to you and you receive what they say. One of the greatest benefits in life is to be able to listen to what a person has to say to you, to receive correction. If you're wrong, to receive it is a benefit to you. It's a benefit to me. One of the greatest benefits in life is to be able to listen when someone speaks to you. But a prideful person, the Bible said a fool hates instruction. A man could be really messing up, but if he's full of pride, if you tell him what you're doing is not right and it's going to cost you, they'll just get angry. They'll just get mad. They'll be angry. The Bible said a fool hates instruction. So The Bible talks a lot in Proverbs about a foolish man. He will not receive correction. He will not receive instruction. But instruction and correction is your friend. It's your benefit. You know, for God to give you correction, but you have to be humble to receive it. If a person tells you what you're doing is wrong, well, chances are they're your friend. They're not trying to hurt you. They're trying to help you. So he said, "All thou shalt remember which the way which the Lord thy God led these 40 years in the wilderness to humble thee and to test thee, to prove thee," means to test thee. God told the children of Israel, "I proved you, I tested you. You went through some tests." He said, "To prove thee or to test thee." God told the nation Israel, "I tested you." Now, let's see what he says. I proved thee or I test thee is what God told Moses, to know what was in thy heart. And I once heard I read this in a book, and it said, trouble don't make a man curse. It says trouble just reveals what's in his heart. You know, the same thing you'd make one man curse and make another man pray. He said, trouble don't make a man curse. It just reveals what's in his heart. Well, God said, "I tested you to know what was in your heart." God told the children of Israel, "I let you go through these tests," and they went through a lot of them, to humble thee, to test you, to know what was in your heart. Listen to what he says. Whether thou would keep his commandments or not. You know, in other words, here's what God is saying. Here's what God was telling the children of Israel. I humbled you. I tested you to know what was in your heart, whether you would keep my commandments or not. That's what God told them. Well, you say, well, why was God wanting to know whether or not they would keep his commandments? He couldn't bless them if they wouldn't keep his commandments. God doesn't bless the disobedient. Nowhere in the Bible does God bless disobedient people. God blesses obedient people. God blesses people that are obedient. You know, the Word of God in Romans chapter 2, it talks about tribulation and anguish upon every soul that sinneth. Sin brings heartache and trouble and sorrow. Obedience brings peace and joy and contentment. You know, obedience brings us the blessings that we want to be obedient. Disobedience brings the things in your life that you do not want. And it's true for anybody. You know, the Bible said anguish, tribulation and anguish upon any soul and upon every soul that sinneth. Romans 2:9. Tribulation and anguish upon every soul that sinneth. God says sin brings tribulation, which is trouble and sorrow and heartache and pain and regret and misery. The things in your life that you absolutely despise is what sin brings. So when Satan, he's your enemy, why he tempts a person to sin is it brings the things in their life that it absolutely harms a person and makes them completely miserable is what sin brings in a person's life. But not only that, God blesses the obedient. You read Deuteronomy 28. God told the nation Israel, if you'll be obedient and keep my commandments and do what I command you, he said, I'll make you the head, not the tail. I'll bless you coming in and going out. Whatever you put your hand to shall prosper. You'll lend to many nations, you shall not borrow. God said, but he kept telling them, if you'll be obedient, I'll bless you. You can go back through all the kings in the Bible, the kings of Judah and the kings of Israel. The kings, they were godly kings in Judah. You know, the nation of Israel were divided into Judah and Israel. Rehoboam was the first king of Judah. Jeroboam was the first king of Israel. They were divided. Jeroboam led the nation Israel into idolatry. But Rehoboam had some godly kings. Judah had some godly kings. It started with Rehoboam, but they had, you know, they had Asa, they had Jehoshaphat. They had some godly kings in Judah. The kings that were godly, God blessed them. You know, when it'll say, and Jehoshaphat did that which was right in the eyes of the Lord, and it'll tell you, God blessed him. Asa was a godly king, and he did that which was right in the sight of the Lord. Well, you got kings in Israel that were ungodly. That's why leaders matter. Don't never let nobody tell you, well, it don't matter who's president. Yes, it does. Read your Bible. The godly men in Israel that were godly kings, God blessed the nation of Judah. He blessed them. When they had godly kings, he blessed the nation. When they had ungodly kings, it didn't go so well for them. Then I've heard people say, don't matter who's president. It does matter. The Word of God says it matters. You know, to have a godly leader, to have someone that believes in God, you know, you don't need a president. You can't say the name of Jesus around. We've done had that, and that didn't work out too well for Christians. But, you know, we're godly people. God blesses godly people. And he told them right here, he said, I shall remember all the way which the Lord thy God led these 40 years in the wilderness to humble thee. So God said, I humbled thee and to prove thee to know what was in thy heart, whether thou would keep his commandments or not. So it comes down, God is telling them, listen to this, this is so important. God's telling the nation of Israel, I want to bless you, but it's going to come down, will you keep my commandments or not? That's true, me and you. Yeah, that is so true with me and you. If you don't believe keeping God's commandments are important, read the first two chapters of the book of Revelation. Read about the church of Ephesus. Did Jesus send them a letter, but John said, you've left your first love. I have somewhat again you. You've left your first love. He wrote that to a church. If you don't think that keeping God's word is important, read the first two chapters of the book of Revelation. Jesus told the church of Ephesus, you've left your first love. He told the church at Laodicea, you're neither hot nor cold, you're lukewarm, and I'll spew you out of my mouth. And he told both churches, says, repent, or God will remove the candlestick, which was the church. So that we're talking about the New Testament. We're talking about what Jesus told John to tell these. There are seven churches. I just named over two, Ephesus and Laodicea, and both of them was out of the will of God. And they're churches. So if you keep God's commandment or don't keep God's commandment, it's all the difference in the world. He said in verse 3, to humble thee, to suffer thee to hunger, and fed thee with manna. In other words, listen to what I fix to say to you. God let them get hungry, then he fed them with manna. Which the word manna means, what is it? He said, which thou knewest not, neither did thy fathers know, that, listen to this, that he may make thee know that man does not live by bread only, but every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of the Lord does man live. So, I want to say two things here. God told the, he told Moses, and Moses is telling the nation Israel, God let you be hungry, and he fed you with manna. that you may realize that man does not live by bread alone, but every word that proceeds out of the mouth of the Lord does man live. So God told the nation Israel, you just don't live on Big Macs and fries. You have to live from the Word of God. You have to live from the Word of God. You have to do what's in the Word of God to be blessed. Remember verse 2, he said, 40 years I humbled you to test you to know what was in your heart, whether you'd keep his commandments or not. So God told Moses, what I want to know, will you keep the Word of God? Will these people keep the Word of God? Because he promised them blessings, but he's telling them, I needed to know whether or not you keep the Word of God. Will you be obedient to the Word of God? Well, a person that's not obedient to the Word of God is miserable. Absolutely miserable. I get those calls every day. People that used to go to church, they don't go to church. They used to be faithful, they're not faithful. And they'll call me, I'm just miserable. Well, because it's impossible to have the joy of the Lord in being disobedient to God. It's impossible to have God's peace and to have God's joy in doing your own thing and letting out of church goofing around. It's impossible. It's impossible. It's impossible for you to have God's peace and to have God's joy and you disobeying him all the time. It's impossible. So God told him, he said, I'm wanting to bless you. I'm wanting to bless. He wants to bless us. Jesus said, I come that you may have life and have it more abundantly. But that's to somebody that's obedient. It's not to a disobedient person. They don't have the abundant life. There's no joy in laying out of church for months at a time, hollering, I'm a Baptist. That's foolishness. There's no joy in that. You're miserable if you do it. You know, sometimes you want to knock on somebody's door and say, dummy, wake up. What you're doing is foolishness. There's no joy in it. It's not going to bring you joy. It's not going to bring you contentment. It's not going to bring you peace. It's not going to bring you happiness. To disobey God steals your joy and it steals your peace. It steals your joy and steals your peace to disobey God, to willfully disobey God, and you know you're disobeying God. So God told these people, I want to bless you. I want to bless you. But I humbled you. I couldn't bless you and you being prideful because pride does its own thing. That's why people does lay out for months at a time. Pride. Pride is a person doing his own thing. Pride's not being obedient to God. A prideful person is not obedient to God. They really don't care. A prideful person, their life is about themselves. It's about totally about themselves. I'm going to do what I want to do when I want to do it. I'm the boss of my life. That's a prideful person. But God told the nation of Israel, I want to bless you, so I had to humble you. He said, I had to humble you. Look what he said. To know what was in your heart, whether you'd keep the word of God or not. I mean, it comes down to that. God said, I want to bless you, but I had to know whether or not you'd keep the word of God or not. I had to know whether or not you'd keep the word of God before I could bless you. He said in verse 3, he humbled thee, says it again. He kept telling the nation of Israel, I had to humble you. I couldn't bless you and you been prideful. I had to humble you before I could bless you. That's what he told me. I had to humble you before I could bless you. I couldn't bless you and you been prideful. You know, the first step to repentance is to be humble. The first step to repenting before God is to be humble. So God, I've sinned. I've come short of your honor and your glory. I've sinned. Well, that takes a humble person to do that, you know. But the first step in repentance is humility. A prideful person never repent. A prideful person never repent. You can read the book of Revelations, and when all the plagues and the, you know, the bowls are emptied out and all the plagues, there are people in Revelation at the end of Revelation that curse God. Their trouble didn't make them turn to God. They cursed God. The Bible said they blasphemed God. They went through the tribulation and they blasphemed God. So their trouble didn't turn them to God. You have to be humble to repent. He said, he humbled thee and suffered thee to hunger and fed thee with manna which thou knew not, neither the fathers know, that he may make thee know that man does not live by bread alone. Man does not live by bread alone. God said, your life is not about what you eat. Your life is in the Word of God. Man shall not live bread alone, but every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of the Lord does man live. God said, man lives by the Word of God. God give us His Word to give us instruction. He give us His Word to teach us. He give us His Word to, that we may be born again, that we may be saved, we may live a victorious life. His word, David said, thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin again. David said, God's word keeps you from sinning. It tells you things you should do and things you shall not do. So, Jesus said, God told Moses, he humbled thee, suffered thee to hunger, and fed thee with manna that thou knew not, neither did the fathers know, that he may make thee know man does not live by bread alone. God told Moses, this is so important. I want everyone to listen to me. God told Moses, I'll let y'all go hungry. Listen what God told him. I'll let y'all go hungry, and I fed you to teach you that you don't live by what you eat, but you live from the Word of God. To this time next week, may God richly bless you. I've enjoyed it. May He richly bless you. May you have a great weekend. May God bless you. Goodbye.